The city of Dnipropetrovsk lies on the Dnipro River, about 200 kilometers west of the disputed territories of Donetsk and Luhansk. The fighting in eastern Ukraine has had a major impact on the people who live there. Some, like Yulia Segeda, say that their lives today are shaped by patriotism and a sense of cohesion.
I grew up on this street, and now I live here too. I used to go walking here with my first daughter, and now I bring my second daughter here as well. I can't imagine living anywhere else. My family and I have traveled a lot. We've tried to live in other places, even in other countries, but I just can't. I'm connected to this soil and this river, and they keep pulling me back. Dnipropetrovsk is the best there is. This city inspires me to play an active role as a citizen.
Yulia is the mother of two children and a successful attorney. And since last summer, she's been an active supporter of the Ukrainian army. She decided to do that because of the increase in fighting in the nearby region of Donetsk. Yulia is one of many volunteers across Ukraine who collect cash donations and supply refugees and the wounded with food and medicine. A ceasefire between rebels and the Ukrainian army was agreed in February, but some fighting continues. So far, the conflict has killed a total of 6,000 people and wounded 14,000. Here, Yulia visits wounded soldiers from a battalion of volunteers.
I come to the front quite often to bring aid supplies. When I meet soldiers of the Ukrainian army, I get the impression that they don't really want to fight. But the guys in these volunteer battalions are real fighters.
We don't get paid for doing this. Things are tough. The government just looks after the army. Without these volunteers, we wouldn't survive. If it weren't for their help, I don't know whether I'd be here right now.
I had a bad experience with the military commanders. It was the first and last time I'll deal with them. So now we bring the supplies directly to the units themselves, because we don't trust anyone.
Volunteers know there's no ceasefire.
We can feel it.
And average folk?
They don't know about the fighting because it's not covered on TV. They talk about a ceasefire. I've just come back from the front and I haven't seen any ceasefire.
We were fighting around Luhansk. There was no ceasefire. The fighting continues. The other side is using Russian tanks, like the B-3, the latest version of the T-72. I saw them myself. They were everywhere. But we couldn't stop them because we don't have any artillery or heavy weapons. After the ceasefire was agreed, the army commanders took it all away. It's not a fair fight at all. I think people will eventually see that this is a nasty and unfair war. But all Ukrainians, men, women, and children, will defend their homes and turn back the enemy. No one here wants to be part of Russia.
The war has become part of everyday life in Dnipropetrovsk. Life appears normal, but the people are tired and demoralized. During the Soviet era, the city was a center of the defense and space industries. Relics of the past are displayed alongside a memorial that honors Maidan activists who were killed in civil unrest in late 2013 and early 2014. They're known as Heaven's Hundred. This military tent was put up recently to provide first aid for people who fled the fighting in eastern Ukraine. Natalia Bornyakova left her home in the Donetsk region last autumn.
I was born in Russia, but when I was 6 months old, our family moved to the Donetsk area in Ukraine. I've lived here all my life. I went to school here, got married, and had two wonderful children. And then the fighting started. I can't remember when I heard the first shots. Every morning at 6, the explosions would start right near our home. I saw rockets flying over the village.
Natalia is a single mother. She's now found a new home for her family in a suburb of Dnipropetrovsk. Natalia got a job with an aid organization, so she can now provide for her children and her mother. They're happy that they're now safe. They still remember vividly what the fighting was like.
The children think about it every day. It scarred them for life. They hid in the cellar at my mother's house. They learned pretty quickly to put on warm clothes and head down to the cellar. They learned in kindergarten that when an air raid starts, you've got to hide. I had to go to work, and I couldn't take them with me. I also couldn't leave them home by themselves. As soon as the fighting started, I'd get a call from the kindergarten, "Come and get your children. We don't have a basement here. Where should we send them?" I just can't describe it.
The children were so frightened. The fighting often started while they were playing outside. They ran into the house and said, "Grandma, they're shooting again," or "There were explosions." They ran inside just like we taught them to.
Не стреляли, а что петарды там гуляются.
Лера cries when she remembers all that. She was frightened, weren't you, Лера?
Да, боялась.
И я боялся там быть.
The explosions scared me too, so I ran inside right away. Лера did too.
Быстрее бы это все закончилось.
I hope all this will end soon. When is Putin going to stop?
Путин.
It's difficult for me to talk about this. I'm really worried about the people who are still there.
Очень страшно. Всех людей, которые там живут.
I can't say anything more. I just want this war to stop.
Father Vasily is pastor of an Orthodox parish in Dnipropetrovsk. Now he also serves as a military chaplain.
Господи помилуй, Господи помилуй, Господи помилуй. Ще молимось за упокоєння душ злочина рабів Божих, невинно обієнних воїнів, невинно обієнного воїна Леоніда, воїна Микаїла,
воїна Віталія, воїна Віктора, воїна Серія, воїна Ільї, воїна Василія, воїна Антона, воїна Михаїла і всіх невинно об'єднаних воїнів, що за віру батьківщину голову положили. Вічна
Father Vasily and his congregation support the troops in various ways. For example, he carries supplies to the front himself.
This is where we store the supplies that have been collected by parishioners. Here's a package of socks, for example. A retired couple have promised to knit 100 pairs of socks for the fighters. Grandpa buys the yarn and Grandma does the knitting. And she puts a piece of candy inside each one. We've got potatoes, cabbage, onions, all sorts of food supplies. There's sausage and other kinds of meat. People bring every kind of food you could imagine.
Люди несуть все, що душа забажає людська принести, а ми вже відповідно, я скажу, тут.
We've been doing this for a year now.
Так потихеньку працюємо.
Yulia Segeda and her husband Alexander, who's also an attorney, are getting ready to travel to the Ukrainian Army's main combat zone. The government says it's carrying out an anti-terrorist operation there.
The army is running low on many kinds of supplies. We were shocked when we found out about it. There were serious shortages last summer. Socks, underwear, shoes, rangefinders, and night vision devices. We didn't know what we should buy first. Is underwear more important than night vision devices? The troops had real fighting spirit, and that's what inspired us to help. When we saw how well they were coping, despite the shortages, we knew that we had to do something. Since then, we've been driving to the front once or twice a week, depending on the amount of supplies that have been donated.
Since last summer, when fighting broke out at the Donetsk airport, the couple have used their business office to store aid supplies.
During the first 2 months, we spent our own money. We decided that, as a family, we wanted to help. But then we found out how much the troops needed. We didn't have enough money to help them and feed our family. So we turned to friends and relatives. Word got around about what we were doing, and other people decided to join us. It's just average folks who are doing this. I've brought a few trophies back from the front. These are old packages of bandages. They were produced in 1966, or 88, or 91. When I find them, I take them away and replace them with new ones. Ukraine is not a military power. The army wasn't prepared for this war. I'd go so far as to say that Ukraine doesn't even have a proper army. It was neglected for 2 decades and nearly destroyed.
The government of Ukraine was simply not prepared for the conflict. For example, there was no plan for dealing with refugees. There were no facilities and no trained personnel. So a group of volunteers opened a reception center in this big tent not far from the train station. Andrei Marchuk, a 22-year-old Maidan activist, traveled here from Kiev to help out.
Right now, they're handing out humanitarian aid to children. Today, it's hygiene products. Okay, I'll work on it. On some days, we get as many as 700 refugees. Sometimes people come here not because they need humanitarian aid, but because they have nowhere else to go. There's no uniform system for registering the refugees so that they can get the help they need. They don't know what they're supposed to do. It's hard to speak openly with the refugees. They don't trust anyone. They come from a region where the rule of law has been violated repeatedly. And when the fighting started, people lost their faith in the local and state authorities. It's exceptionally difficult to create trust.
This facility is located at the tram depot. Refugees can stay here for a few days until they find a place of their own. Volunteers provide essential care for new arrivals. The key question for most refugees is how to find a job in this unfamiliar environment.
They know we've got social services here and an employment center where they can find out what jobs are available. Most of the jobs aren't that great, but that's the way it is.
Despite the ceasefire agreement signed in Minsk in February 2015, refugees continue to arrive from the Donbas region. Many had to leave their homes in a hurry, and now they're forced to get by on donations.
It was horrible. I've never experienced anything like it. On the night of February 12th, there was a huge explosion. Rockets flew over our house and hit the kindergarten. The explosion shattered the windows and knocked everything off the balcony. My son was ill. I sat with him all night in the bathroom. It was terrible. We never got used to the explosions. Natalia's family lived near the site of a major battle where pro-Russian separatists routed the Ukrainian army. She'd made friends with some of the Ukrainian soldiers. That would soon have dangerous consequences.
A fighter from the 39th Battalion called me and asked whether I could hide two soldiers. One of them was wounded. I said, sure. The troops waited until it was dark. I went out to meet them. We ran through backyards to get to my place. Both men were in bad shape. The wounded man called Sasha had been shot through the ear and had a wound on his cheek. They stayed with me for 2 days. Sasha didn't allow me to treat his wounds. I gave him a shot of antibiotics. That was to reduce the risk of inflammation. Later, two volunteers came by and took the soldiers away. Our neighbors, a couple of elderly women, told everyone what I'd done, and eventually the separatists heard about it. The People's Republic of Donetsk was declared on the same day as the soldiers left my home.
Уже у нас ДНР был.
Soon, separatists arrived and searched Natalia's house, and her mother's house as well. They threatened Natalia and demanded to know where the Ukrainian soldiers were hiding.
They pounded on my front door and yelled, "Are you going to come out, or do we have to come in and get you?" I said, "I'm getting dressed. I was asleep. The kids are sleeping. Don't make so much noise." I went outside. They took me to another village nearby and led me into a cellar. They cursed me and insulted me. They threatened to kill me and my family if I didn't cooperate. While we were walking to the village, I said to myself, "I'm not going to come back from this."
Later, the rebels allowed Natalia to return home. Ukrainian soldiers helped her to escape. This weekend, just like about every weekend, Yulia Sageda and her husband are traveling to the combat zone, specifically the area around Donetsk.
I live in Ukraine, and I want my children to live here too. I help the army because it brings out my maternal instincts. I want my children to live in a country that's safe and a city that's safe. But right now, we're basically living near a war zone. The front line is only about 3 hours away by car. When we started making our deliveries in the summer, it was just 2 hours. It was so awful to know that the war was just a couple of hours away. We had to do something.
This part of the Donetsk region is still controlled by Ukrainian troops. The fighting has caused a lot of damage and has forced many people to leave their homes. The United Nations estimates that 1.5 million people have left eastern Ukraine since the conflict began.
Right now, we're close to the military hospital at Krasnoarmeysk. It's actually a mobile field hospital that opened just recently. The hospitals at the front didn't have room for all the wounded, so they set up a mobile unit here.
Doctors asked Yulia and her husband to bring medicine and surgical instruments. So they did. They have to move fast because they're due to make deliveries to 3 more army units.
I take supplies to the mobile brigades first of all, and then I do the rest. It's become really difficult to set up the emergency dispensaries because all the component parts have to meet NATO standards.
Not far from the military hospital, Yulia's husband has to stop and fix a flat tire. While she's waiting, she meets some children and hands out some food parcels that she's brought along.
Here you go.
Thanks. Glory to Ukraine.
Again.
Glory to Ukraine.
Glory to our heroes.
Thanks. There was lots of shooting. Even while the talks in Minsk were underway, there was a lot of shooting near the coal piles. We hit the ground, just like our parents told us to.
And now?
Things have calmed down. Our soldiers are nice to us. They give us stuff and talk to us. They don't yell at us. They treat us like we're their own kids.
We started driving to the front ourselves because a lot of the supplies were being stolen. Supplies don't get to the military depots or they're seized along the way. We didn't want that to continue. We've paid for these supplies with our own money, so we want to make sure that they get to the soldiers who need them. We decided to do it this way.
Father Vasily also often visits the front.
I've been going into the combat zone from the very start because the people from our parish are fighting there. These are people who were praying with us in church just the other day. Then they leave their homes and families to defend our independence, our country, and our soil. Sometimes they have doubts about what they're doing, because in this conflict they have to kill people, even Orthodox believers like themselves. We go to the front to give the troops moral and spiritual support. We hear confessions, and we celebrate the Eucharist. The troops see that we're not afraid to be with them. Even when we're fired at, we go right back the next day. Of course, we're concerned about the danger because each of us has a family. But if we just think about ourselves and ignore the greater good, what does that say about us? Almighty God tells us to sacrifice ourselves for the sake of others.
Back at the refugee center, some people have just arrived from Donetsk. Andrei Marchuk tries to find them transportation so they can get where they want to go. Many end up staying with relatives and friends. A lot of the refugees fled because of the fighting, but many also ran out of food and water, and their homes were heavily damaged.
The key's there.
And the neighbors?
No, it's in the door.
What was it like out there? The window and frame were blown out. We had to cover it. Last week it was pretty quiet, but the day before yesterday there was some firing from the airport, which is occupied by the rebels. But that was a long way off. Usually it's really loud, but that time it was okay. I'm an invalid. Also, from August to October, I was in bed with a high fever. I couldn't get down to the cellar because I had so little strength. Then winter came. It might sound funny, but I had to sell my gold teeth just to survive. That's pretty funny.
That's sad.
It would be funny if it weren't so sad. When I came to Dnipropetrovsk, everything was so quiet. In fact, it was so quiet I couldn't fall asleep at night. The people here were really nice to me. This city has now become my home. I feel like I've been living here all along.
A state of emergency has been declared in Dnipropetrovsk. Still, a rally has been scheduled to celebrate Ukraine's independence, and above all, its unity. The country has developed a new national identity over the past few months. I'm ready to sacrifice myself for Ukraine. I'm ready to fight on the front line. I've asked myself whether I should go to the combat zone to join my friends. I want to be there with them. But they won't let me because I have two children. They say I should stay in the city, where I can do work that will help.
Glory to Ukraine. 150,000 people have found a new home in our region. They came to us in an emergency because of the war in the east. The war forced them to leave their homes. A big thanks to all residents of Dnipropetrovsk who've helped these people find new homes. I am sure that we will all help them to get settled here, but the most important thing is that they must be able to return home one day.
The highlight of the rally is an appearance by Ukrainian-born singer Ruslana, who won the 2004 Eurovision Song Contest.
There's a real Ukrainian spirit here on this square today. Dnipropetrovsk has saved Ukraine. Everyone knows that. So I've come here today to support you in these uncertain times. I want you to know that Ruslana from Lviv is always with you. I've come here today because this city is supporting all of Ukraine. And all Ukrainians know that.
Our lives have changed a lot. Before the war, we were successful attorneys. We certainly weren't poor. We wore designer clothes and ate in fine restaurants. But now we don't go out or buy nice things. Instead of having dinner in a restaurant, we buy hemostatic bandages, tourniquets, and emergency pharmaceutical supplies. I calculate all my expenses in terms of hemostatic bandages.
The city of Dzerzhinsk was briefly occupied by troops of the People's Republic of Donetsk. The Ukrainian army managed to take back the city, but the rebels continued to shell parts of it. Their positions are located just a few kilometers outside the city limits. These Ukrainian troops are learning how to use hemostatic bandages.
Let's try this a different way. Maybe it'll work better. That's it. Good.
Like this?
Leave a 15-centimeter strip. Then bend the adhesive and it's ready to go. Keep that strip on the outside of the hand and hold it like that. This is a people's war, because it's the Ukrainian people who are actually doing the fighting. Some are at the front, others work in the supply chain. When the guys see that I, a woman, have brought them some supplies, it gives them strength.
Meanwhile, in Dnipropetrovsk, Natalia and her family are adjusting well to their new surroundings. The children are even attending kindergarten. But Natalia is worried about her sister Oksana, who's still in the region controlled by separatists. She has no money, and her daughter is ill. Natalia tries to stay in contact by phone.
Hello.
Hi, Oksana.
Hi.
What's going on there?
What?
What's going on there?
We want to join you there. Things are bad here. We want to be with you.
Oksana.
I can't take it anymore.
Oksana, please don't cry. We've talked to some volunteers who bring families to safety.
Люди займаються вивозом жінок і дітей.
We'll do everything we can to get you out of there. Can you drive to Donetsk on your own?
Sure.
Good.
Kiss Vika for us.
All our love, and don't cry.
We can't stand it here.
Calm down.
I'm going to the neighbors now to get some salt. We don't have any.
What can you do?
The church has changed, and there's been a change in people's consciousness. Our nation has matured because now we can see that we can change things, that people deserve a better life. The volunteer fighters have given us a real push forward. Our government was financially quite weak, and the army was falling apart. And if average people hadn't supported the volunteers, who knows how things would have turned out for us?
We're building a new Ukraine. I think our country must renew itself in every way. This includes creating a legal system that's fair and humane. I'm familiar with the European legal system, and I want to see it established here.
Поэтому, конечно, мне хочется, чтобы в Украине был тоже европейский судебный порядок.
Reforms are essential, and I say that not only as someone who lives in a big city, but also as someone who works at the front. But it's tough to implement reforms in a country that's fighting a war.
Гораздо сложнее реализовываться, чем в мирное время.
Я
I tried to call my sister. Actually, I tried to call her neighbors who have a mobile phone. But I couldn't get through. I also tried to call a friend of mine who lives there. But I couldn't get through to anyone. I don't know what to do now. I have no idea who I should call.
All the work that I'm doing now in the combat zone, I'm doing for this city and for these children. There's such a contrast between life here and what you see there. Just 3 hours ago, I was sitting in a shelter at the front. Rockets were flying over us, and you could hear the guns firing, the sounds of war. And when we came back the next day, I close my eyes and I can hear the voices of the children. And the other sounds too, laughing, crying, running around, the sounds of their bikes. When I close my eyes and I hear all that, I remember why I went to the front yesterday.